Joining me now here in Washington, Republican Senator John McCain of Arizona. We are at that point in foreign policy where our values are just running headlong into our strategic interests. I asked Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, who do we back? Do we back Mubarak or do we back the people on the street? And she said, well, we back the Egyptian people, which was a little different to her from the people on the street. Is it time to cut him loose?
Not cut him loose, but also I think one of the lessons here is that we need to be on the right side of history in these countries, and we need to do a better job of emphasizing and arguing strenuously for human rights. And I understand how important, and I hope we all do, how important Egypt as an ally, as a center of culture, and one out of every four Arabs in the Middle East live in Egypt, and how important they are. But it was clear for a long time that the kind of repressive regime that Mubarak controls, sooner or later there was going to be great difficulties. Good news, I think, is that the army is playing a very constructive role. So I think what we need to do now is to lay out kind of a plan for Mubarak to lift the state of emergency, announce that elections free and fair will be held in September, which were already planned, allow a open and free democratic process, which I think we could have some confidence if it was an open process, that you would see a free and fair election, and make sure that the aspirations of the Egyptian people are realized finally. And it's fraught with danger, as you our earlier guessed, the Muslim Brotherhood, the Iranian example, and others, but there's also a good chance for a real functioning democracy and arguably the most important nation in the Middle East.
But, you know, for 30 years, Republican and Democratic presidents have publicly at times, mostly privately, as we saw in some of those leaked WikiLeaks cables from the diplomatic cables, that they've said, you've got to do something here. You can't be an authoritarian. It didn't work. It was 30 years of not. I mean, he'd do something and we'd go, oh, thanks, and then we'd sort of retreat. So what else could have been done? Isn't he too important to us? Wasn't he too important to us?
Madeleine Albright and I sent a letter before the last election saying, allow observers in. Russ Feingold and I sponsored a resolution calling for more respect of human rights. Isn't a lesson of history, you cannot have autocratic, repressive regimes last forever. And the longer they last, the more explosive are the results. And that's a lesson that we have to learn, that all of these rights that individuals have is not confined to the United States of America and our allies. And so I still think that we have a real opportunity to see a democratic transition. And by the way, could I also mention, Jordan is very serious situation in Jordan. Yemen is a country that's fraught with more problems than we can take the time to describe on this program, even as far away as Libya. So this is a very critical time. What happens in Egypt will directly and dramatically affect what happens in these other countries. There is a real awakening going on.
But we're also talking about other U.S. allies in the area who we have joined forces with, and they're not exactly democracies. Jordan, Saudi Arabia, places like that. Now what? I mean, on Capitol Hill, you all had the ability to cut aid to these countries, but Egypt is number two in foreign aid after Israel. So
yes. And I think that we have to say that everything is on the table and encourage and help and assist in a process that leads to a free and fair election. I have confidence in the Egyptian people that they're not going to elect an extremist. They're not going to allow an extremist group to hijack their country. And they will, and that can be prevented if we have a fair, open process beginning now. Between now and September, you could have the rise of political parties. You could have a real democratic process that could be celebrated throughout the region and a model for the rest of the region. The other is, of course, is hang on, more demonstrations, the army turns one way. There's all kinds of bad scenarios here and really only one good one. But I would say I think the president's statement was correct. Now we need to take a step further. And we've got to be on the right side of history here.
I guess the problem is that we've been at them for 30 years to change, I wonder why they would listen to us, why Mubarak would listen to us now.
Well, obviously, he's in an extremist position. The army is now the critical institution. The police, as we all know, have disappeared. It's the only real stabilizing force in the country right now. Fortunately, we've had very close relations with the Egyptian military. There's a lot of very good, strong people there. So, and also, I think that President Mubarak, he knows what's going on in his own country. It's up to the United States to be a helpful, assisting, but insisting partner. And by the way, we cannot afford a Tiananmen Square in Cairo.
And that's the question, I guess, when you look at these streets throughout Egypt, not just in Cairo, do you see a group willing to wait till September to get rid of Hosni Mubarak?
I think that the group, and I don't pretend to know the sentiment on the street, but it seems to me logic if Mubarak said, I'm not going to run again, I am turning over this government to a caretaker that you could trust, probably with the army involved, they're not going to have any further political aspirations, and we'll set up a process for a free, open, transparent election in September. I think you could do that, but this is a narrow window of opportunity. The longer the unrest exists, the more likely it is to become extreme.
Tell me how you think the president has done so far. Sounds like you think mm-hmm. he's done pretty well, and what do you want him to do next?
I think the president should get a little bit more out ahead. I think his statement that he made day before yesterday was good. Well, I think, in other words, lay out a scenario of what we think that the Egyptian people should have every right to expect, the kind that I just described. The past performance of this administration hasn't been great. They cut off some of the money for democratization, etc. But we can review that at a later time. The important thing is I think the president made the right statement. I think that the Secretary of State made a good presentation to you. I just want to see her go a little bit further, and let's get out in front on this issue on behalf of the things we've always stood for and believed in. And every time we've been on the right side of history, it's usually turned out okay.
What is your, I asked Negroponte and Walker before you, what do you fear the most watching this? Because there's so much uncertainty right now that we really don't know which way is going.
Well, my great fear is obviously a radical Islamic extremist, the Iran scenario versus the Philippine or other scenario. That's all of our greatest fear. But the longer there's unrest, the more likely the radicals are see openings to take power. The Lenin scenario. So that's my greatest fear. My second greatest fear, of course, is started in Tunisia, Egypt. We see problems in Yemen, Jordan, our dearest, most important, very important ally. This could be a seminal moment in history of the Middle East. And the question is that turn out good, or does it turn out to the advantage of radical Islamic extremism? And I don't know the answer yet.
I don't either. So
Egypt will be key, though.
We will have you back when the answers become clearer.
Thanks so much, Senator.
I appreciate it. Up next, we want to talk to Senator McCain's Democratic colleague, Senator Chuck Schumer of New York.